Okay, so very good evening to everyone. Welcome and thank you very much for joining. So before we kickstart the lectures of the STEMS 2022 final camp, I, on behalf of the entire team of STEMS, would like to extend our hearty congratulations on making it this far. So we sincerely hope that you had a great learning experience and will continue to do so throughout the rest of your life. So setting the ball rolling in the final leg of the campaign, I'm pleased to introduce Professor Archana, an assistant professor of physics at IIT Bombay. Her research interests are primarily in areas surrounding gravitational waves. She's a recipient of numerous accolades, including the 2021 Serb Power Fellowship, the 2016 Gruber Prize in Cosmology, and the Special Breakthrough Prize, the latter for her LIGO-Virgo collaboration. Today, Professor Archana will talk to us about the growth of gravitational wave astronomy, and we'll also be touching upon the LIGO-Virgo collaboration. So just a quick instruction, please use the chat box or the raise hand options if you have any questions at any point during the talk, and we'll take them as appropriate. So without any further ado, over to you, Professor Archana.
Thank you very much, Aniruddhan, and congratulations to all the participants. I hope I will be able to shine some light on the recent discovery of gravitational waves and the astronomy that sort of opened up the new branch of astronomy. All right. So I have sort of this title, Growth of Gravitational Wave Astronomy, itself is sort of indicative that this is a new branch of astronomy, and I'm going to tell you how this branch is growing for last few years. There is a big coincidence that this talk I'm giving on February 11, 2022, exactly 6 years ago, we announced the discovery of gravitational waves to the entire world, and we celebrated the final prediction of Einstein after almost a century. All right, so let's begin. Start the story. Few centuries ago. Okay, and let's just try to lay down a little bit of foundation of gravitational waves. I will try to make this as pedagogical as possible, and try to convey the essence of general relativity and gravitational waves. Okay, so all of you must be knowing about the famous Galileo-Galilei experiment, where you can see here Galileo, who is instructing to drop these two balls, right, the metal balls from the Leaning Tower of Pisa. And as all of you know, the goal is to sort of measure when the two balls sort of reach the ground. And after repeated experiments, what they discovered is that irrespective of the mass or the material or size, or both the balls basically fall on the ground at the same time. And this experiment essentially laid the foundations of equivalence principle, which later on Einstein converted into a very beautiful mathematical theory of gravity. And essentially the equivalence principle says, and I think all of you, even starting from the school, when we try to solve Newton's laws, right? And let's say you're trying to compute the motion of an object under gravity, then we write down the Newton's law as, ma is equal to minus mg, and then you strike off both m's. And this striking off is, we do it, we think it's very natural, and we didn't even think that whatever we are doing, we never really question this. But that is where the equivalence principle comes in. So basically here your 1 m is essentially the source of force, right? And the other m is essentially is the inertial mass, which is associated to the object. And it is to it's a property of the object that when you apply the force, how the object should move. And there is no necessity that both these masses should be same. And in fact, the equivalence principle tells you that these two masses are indeed the same. And of course, there are experiments which people have set up and trying to test whether are these two masses indeed the same. And this was essentially the foundation of Einstein's general theory of relativity. And what are the consequences of that? So essentially, the equivalence principle essentially tells you how the motion of the objects will be under gravity. It completely formulated the concept of gravity and the way we view the gravity. Okay. And the whole mapping is done in geometry and the motion of the object in the curved geometry. So for example, if you look at this sun here, so this is a sun, this is Earth, and this fabric, which you can see is not real fabric, but essentially it's a space-time. So you can just think this to be a geometry around sun. And the way this is essentially shown, which is deformed, this deformation is because of this this massive sun, okay? And essentially the dip is most where in the neighborhood of the sun, okay? And the way you should view this is that if, let's say, you treat Earth to be walking in this deformed fabric, okay, then the way Earth moves around the sun is nothing but just the motion of Earth on this deformed fabric, and that is how you view gravity. Okay, so the essence of Einstein's general theory of relativity is that any matter, okay, defines the geometry around itself. So when I say geometry, it's basically space and time together. So when you say space and time is at different time slides, how the space is, okay? And then the geometry will decide how the objects will move. Will follow their motion basically, okay? So for example, so that is what I've said. So I think very intuitively, you can map this problem. I said again, this is very loose, very loosely speaking, that you can imagine this fabric to be, let's say, any elastic fabric, okay? And if you consider this to be a small ball, which is, you know, moving on this fabric, then essentially it just follows the way the fabric is sort of, at a given location, okay? If you assume everything is frictionless and so that you are not losing anything because of friction. So, and Einstein also showed that if you take weak gravity and if the velocities are much, much, much smaller than the speed of light, then you can actually show that the Einstein's equations, which I have not put it here, but they are very nonlinear equations. They essentially just boils down to our simple Newton's law of gravitation. So the Newton's law of gravitation is, it is valid under basically weak gravity and small velocities. And we all know that all our motions of the planets around the sun, we can easily explain with Newton's law of gravitation, maybe except the motion of the Mercury. And the Newton's law is valid in this because we are living in the domain of weak gravity and small velocity. All right. So this is the essence of Einstein's general theory of relativity. And gravitation waves are predictions of this theory. And I'm just going to show you a simple video by which you can sort of understand. So let's consider that there are two objects, and according to Einstein's theory, each of these objects will have their own geometry around them. And if you consider them to be, let's say, in a binary system. So when I say binary system, it means you have isolated objects Okay. And they are basically, they're bound with gravity, and they are just moving in orbit around them, okay, around each other. So that is essentially is a binary, and consider that this is a binary system. And what would happen is, as they move around each other, okay, as they are moving, okay, locally, the geometry will change with their motion. And as a result, this change in geometry will depict as waves sort of, you know, going away from the source. So I'll just play the video for you so that you understand graphically what is happening. So you have these two objects, and each are having their geometry, and as they move, okay, they will produce waves, which are essentially ripples on this geometry, okay, and which will propagate away from the source, okay. So you can see, and this is what we call it as a gravitational wave. Now, according to this, essentially, when you have any binary system, irrespective of their masses, okay, it should produce gravitational waves, or even in more generally, okay, gravitational waves have certain properties, okay. So they are like light waves, which are transverse in nature, okay. So basically, the deformations are perpendicular to the direction of propagation, and they travel with speed of light, just like electromagnetic waves in vacuum, and they radiate away this bulk asymmetry in the form of waves. Okay. And if anybody is interested to do some rough calculation of how much gravitational waves any object or any system can produce, and here there is a little formula for you, so you guys can go and check. Okay, so G is the gravitational constant, R is the distance to the source, C is the speed of light, and this is something called as a double derivative of a quadrupole moment. Okay, so you can go and Google what is a double derivative. Physically, quadrupole moment is a measure of symmetry of an object. So for example, if you take a sphere and you compute the quadrupole moment of the sphere measured from the center, then the quadrupole moment will be zero. Okay. If you want to do actual calculation, I will strongly recommend you to do this calculation. You please check the formula of quadrupole moment and you can do this calculation. Okay. But as far as our today's talk is concerned, you can consider quadrupole moment to be essentially mass times the dimension square. Okay, it has basically the dimensionality of mass times typical size of the object square. Okay, just like when you talk about dipole is essentially the mass times the size of the object dimensionally. Okay, so now if that is the case, then you can treat this as Q as something like m times r square or l square and divided by dt square. So this is something like a kinetic energy. Okay, but this is a measure of asymmetric kinetic energy, because if the object is symmetric or isotropic, okay, then the quadrupole moment is zero. So this is what we call it as, you know, asymmetric kinetic energy. And using this formula, you can actually do order of magnitude calculation of the amplitude of gravitational waves. So this is the amplitude of gravitational waves, which we always denote by h. Okay. There is one more point which you need to note, that this h is inversely proportional to the distance to the source. Okay. So essentially, if you go, let's say, twice deeper, okay, then essentially h goes. Basically goes down by a factor of 2. Okay. All right. So now if you guys have understood this little formula, I'm going to do a little calculation for you and try to convince yourself that this H is extremely tiny object. Okay. So for example, okay, so this is the same video here. This is just a sort of pictorial, graphical understanding of gravitational waves. All right, so let's consider let's consider this system. Okay, so there is a rod here, okay, some metal rod, and imagine this metal rod is spinning, okay, around this axis. All right, and I have given some typical numbers here. So let's say the length of this rod is 10 meters, the frequency is, let's say, 10 hertz, and the mass is 1000 kilograms. Okay, it's a massive rod. Of course, let's not worry about tension and, you know, Young's modulus and things like that. Okay, so let's assume that this it's a hypothetical scenario where the rod remains as it is without bending, etc. And imagine that this rod is spinning somewhere in US. Okay, so essentially the distance from between you and the rod is roughly the diameter of the Earth. Okay, now if that is the case, you can do the calculation as I gave you in the previous slide. And if I do that calculation for you, you can go and do it at home if you want. Then the H comes out to be 10 to the power minus 44. So minus 44 is basically 1 divided by 1. And on 1, there are 44 zeros. So basically, this number is extremely tiny. And such a tiny number, it's very difficult for us to detect. Okay, or I mean, even if this rod is spinning and you want to measure the gravitational waves, it is it's nearly impossible to design experiments to detect such tiny amplitude. Now let's go to the astrophysical objects. So let's consider a binary system as we just talked about. Okay, so two stars, let's say two compact objects, they are in binary orbit with, let's say, a period of 8 hours. And let's say they are separated by million kilometers somewhere sitting in our galaxy. Okay. So when I say in our galaxy, I would say something like few kiloparsec. Right. So our galaxy, the extent of our galaxy is something like 300 parsec to 30 kiloparsec. So few kiloparsec is inside our galaxy. Okay. One parsec is 3 × 10^16 meters. All right, so now if you do this, repeat the calculation, the same calculation for such an object, then you will find that the same H, the amplitude of gravitational waves emitted from such a system is something like 10 to our minus 21. So please note the, you know, increase in the power. So it's almost like 23 orders of magnitude, what we say, basically. This number you get when you multiply this number by 10 to the power 23, right? So you get a huge increase in the amplitude of gravitational waves. And that is the reason why we look for sources in the outer space. And these sources also should have certain properties which will emit gravitational waves, which can be detected, all right? Okay, so now are there only binary systems which emit gravitational waves? No, there are lots of other systems which also emit gravitational waves. Of course, the majority of the systems are compact binaries. The reason is that they are compact objects. I will come to in a while what is a compact object. But there are sources like, for example, when you have let's say a star like Sun, or maybe 10 times the mass of the Sun, or even bigger star, once it consumes its fuel, okay, then it goes through various stages of its life. And eventually, if the star is massive, then it goes through supernova explosion, as I've shown here. And such a supernova explosion can produce gravitational waves. Okay, the thumb rule is that any system which essentially produces non-zero derivative of quadrupole moment. Okay, so that produces gravitational waves. If you have, let's say, you know, merging galaxies, so imagine you have two nearby galaxies which are merging. So I think some of you might be knowing that our neighboring galaxy Andromeda, it is actually approaching us. Okay, so if you have merging galaxies, then these spiral galaxies, you have at the center, you have supermassive black holes. You have very massive black holes. And when they merge, basically these two massive black holes, supermassive black holes, they can form a binary system, and that can emit gravitational waves. Similarly, if you have, let's say, a rotating neutron star, so basically, depending upon the mass of the system, when at the end stages of stellar evolution, it can form either a neutron star or a black hole. Okay. And if you have a neutron star, and let's say if it is rotating, and if there is some asymmetry, or there is some mountain on the neutron star, then when it rotates, it's going to produce a non-zero quadrupole moment, and that would also emit gravitational waves. Similarly, let's say you have a system like this where there is a black hole at the center. Okay, there is a very compact object at the center, and because of very massive, it's a massive object, also compact, so it has a very strong gravitational pull. Then it tries to pull matter from this nearby companion star, and when such a system, when there is a mass transfer happening, that can also emit gravitational waves. Okay, so there are lots of sources, and there are sources which possibly we do not know, which might be observing gravitational waves and filling the whole universe. Okay, all right. So now the question is, okay, so if according to Einstein's theory, there are gravitational waves are produced because of non-isotropic motion of systems. Okay, then when they arrive, and if we want to build detectors, then how do we detect them? Okay, so according to Einstein's gravity, gravitational waves have two polarizations. Okay, and here I have sort of drawn a ring of particles. Okay, and these two polarizations, they are called plus polarization and cross polarization. I will tell you why they are called plus and cross. So imagine that if you have a ring of particles, and imagine that the gravitational waves are incident perpendicular to this plane. Okay, so if that is the case, then as the gravitational waves propagate, okay, they would essentially change. Okay, because as the gravitational wave pass, okay, they are going to produce ripples, right? And because of this ripples, the distance between the objects will be different, and that will oscillate depending upon the frequency of the gravitational waves. Okay, so if you have a ring like this, and as they pass, I will show you how this ring will alter. Okay, so you can take, let's say, here you have a cylinder and the gravitational waves are coming like this. Then you look at this, the circular cross section, and see how the particles are moving. Okay, depending upon the polarization gravitational waves, the ring will essentially deform, either following plus sign or following cross sign. Okay, so these are called as the plus polarization and cross polarization gravitational waves. So the polarization is basically the way we understand is how these polarizations affect the matter when it sort of falls on the surface. Okay, so these are the two polarizations of gravitational waves in Einstein's theory. All right. So now this we can use, the fact that the gravitational wave sort of deforms space-time, and as a result, the distance between two points essentially change. This can be used in building detectors, and that is what people have done. Okay, so let's go back to, let's say, in 70s, okay, early 60s, Professor Joseph Weber from University of Maryland, he was the first who proposed metal bars to detect gravitational waves. So so this is Professor Joe Weber, and this is the first detector of gravitational waves. It was a metal bar, and the idea was that if you have passing gravitational waves, and imagine if the frequency of these gravitational waves are sort of coincident with the resonant mode of the metal bar, then that would excite, and you can essentially amplify this excitation, and then you can detect it. Okay, so that was the main idea. Now, interestingly, look at the year here. In 1968, Joe Weber declared that he detected gravitational waves. So this is the Physical Review Letter paper. It's a publication. And you can see here the title is Gravitational Wave Detector Events. And this created a lot of excitement in the field. And in order to test the results, because earlier what people thought was that, okay, I mean, these amplitudes are so tiny and there is no way we can detect these. In fact, even Einstein was very skeptical whether we can ever detect these gravitational waves. However, the announcement by Professor Joe Weber essentially created so much excitement that there were several resonant bar detectors were built all over the globe. Okay, in MIT, in IBM, Glasgow, Germany, Italy, all over, to just confirm the results. And that essentially marked the beginning of the hunt of gravitational waves. Eventually, all these detectors and successive experiments by Joe Weber confirmed that whatever he announced was essentially non-astrophysical. However, the whole momentum essentially started because of this historical event. Successively, around the same time, actually, in 1957, Felix Pirani, in one of the conferences, he essentially showed that you can use light signal to measure the distance between the free test masses. So if you have, let's say you build an experiment where all the test masses are sort of, you know, you remove all the terrestrial influences and they are free, then you can use the light signals to measure the distance between them. And this was the principle behind the idea which Rainer Weiss used in LIGO, which is a laser interferometry gravitational wave observatory, that you can use laser interferometers to detect gravitational waves. Okay, the team essentially made the first proposal, and of course all the design, when I say design, I mean that also includes noise, because it is not just a simple interferometer, simple Michelson interferometer, because it has to be, the masses should be such that this should be free test masses. So you have to, you know, eliminate all the terrestrial noise sources. And for that, you have to make a lot of technical designs. And all that thing happened. And the full LIGO proposal was submitted to NSF in late 80s. Now, what is the principle? So I'm going to play a little video so that we all are on the same page. So imagine, there is a laser beam, and this is the interferometer. It's a very basic interferometer where you have two mirrors here, okay? And this is a beam splitter, which splits the beam into parts. It goes and to one end, reflects, comes back. And this beam then combines with the other beam, which is coming from the other mirror, and it finally interferes. And then here you collect the intensity of the beam. Okay, so this is a basic interferometer. Now imagine that the gravitational waves are incident. So you can see the effect of gravitational waves. So there would be change in the distance between the two points, and that will get reflected in the change in the intensity of the light where you're gathering. Okay, so this is the basic principle of interferometer and the interferometric detector like LIGO used as gravitational wave detector. Okay, now here the crucial point is that the change in length, which is dl, depends on h, which is the amplitude of gravitational waves, and l, which is the length of the arm. So higher is the arm, then you can measure higher dl, okay, and which is better. Okay, so hence you need to basically, they decided to construct longer and longer arm length laser interferometers. All right. So the current LIGO is 4 kilometer arm length. And if let's say H is 10 to the power minus 21, as we did that back of the envelope calculation, then essentially you are trying to probe DL of the order of 10 to the power minus 18 meters, which is essentially 1,000th of the size of the nucleus. So using this phase measurement, you can actually probe such tiny phase differences, because you're essentially measuring the phase difference, which comes from the change in the length. All right. So these are the two LIGO detectors. You can see that they are essentially stretching and, in the fields. Hanford is not in the field, but essentially quite in the outskirts of the bustling of the city. And essentially the layout which I showed you, you have a laser which is beam splitter. At this point, the light goes all the way here and comes back, reflects, and again it gets interfered and then gets collected at this station. Okay. All right, so you can understand the vastness of this experiment. And besides just this this thing, there are lots of crucial elements which I would like to just spend a few minutes on this, because without talking about the crucial elements of the experiment, it's very difficult to understand how we can probe something like H of the order of 10 to the power minus 18. So the experiment is not just a simple Michelson interferometer, as I demonstrated to you, but there are cavities, what they call it as the Fabry-Perot cavities. Okay, so this is the cavity, which you can see. So there is a mirror here, and there is also a mirror here, which essentially multiply reflects the light within this cavity. And because of this multiple reflection, the effective arm length of the interferometer is increased. Okay, so and that helps in improving the DL, which we discussed a slide ago. All right, so there is this Fabry-Perot cavities is used. The whole thing, each mirror is essentially suspended. So there is a multiple suspension, because the pendulum, and in fact, the cascade of pendulum, if some of you who have done classical mechanics might recall that the cascade of pendulum actually acts like a very good filter. Okay, so they essentially cut down the frequencies, and as a result, you can essentially, you can make the system free of the terrestrial noise sources. The whole thing is put in the high vacuum. Okay, it's an ultra high vacuum. And also the suspension, the threads, they are extremely low loss suspension, so that you're not losing anything. And the mirrors are highly reflective, and you have a very high laser power, because the high power laser beams helps in reducing certain noise components. So now with all these technical details, essentially the whole LIGO is built, and all these things. So you can imagine that there is when you say multi-stage suspension, four stage suspension, then each suspension, they have their own modes, okay? Different oscillation modes, and you have to all control their motion, okay? And all that thing is done using electronics, etc., okay? So it's basically it's a huge technological achievement. LIGO is to achieve the sensitivity of H, what we are talking about, of such a tiny number. All right. So with all those improvements, at the beginning of in mid 2015, okay, the sensitivity, that is the H, what we were talking about, okay, H in a particular unit, we achieved H to be order of 10 to the power minus 24 at 100 hertz here. Okay, and this was a very impressive sensitivity, and which was achieved at the beginning of the first observation run of the LIGO detectors. And that took us very close to the gravitational wave discovery. All right, so what happened? So, okay, so before we go to gravitational wave discovery, I just want to spend a little bit time on when you talk about the compact binaries, right? So the compact binaries are essentially a binary system, which we just talked about. And what happens is when you have a binary system, the two objects are going around each other. Now, when they're going around each other, they're essentially losing energy to gravitational waves. And as a result, they come close to each other. When they come close to each other, using Kepler's law, you know that the frequency of the gravitational waves or of the orbital frequency essentially will increase. Okay, so they are attracted more and they move with higher orbital frequency, or they move faster basically. Okay, so they move faster and then they will come further close to each other. They will release some energy and they come close to each other and eventually they merge. Okay, so that is what we here have shown. So this is a signal emitted by this such a system. You can see as the time goes, the frequency is increasing and the amplitude is also increasing. Okay, so there is amplitude increasing, frequency is increasing here. And finally, it merges. Finally, they merge. And once the two objects merge, there is a big boom. And then a final object essentially settles. Okay, and when something is settling, it essentially what we call as rings. Okay, it's something like you take a metal sphere and try to tap the sphere. When you tap the metal sphere, you hear this ringing kind of sound. That's a ringing. Okay, so here this is a ring down. Okay, where it's just trying to ring and settle. Okay, so essentially this the gravitational wave signal from the binary merger is made up of three phases. There is an in spiral phase where the two objects are in spiraling to each other. Then there is a merger phase, and then there is a ring down phase where it is settling. Okay. So what happens is, depending upon the orientation of the binary, okay, you will see different kinds of waveforms. Okay. So these are different. This is just a zoo of waveforms emitted by binary system of, let's say, different spins, different orientation, how we are looking at them, and so on and so forth. Okay. And as they enter, so as the frequency increases, as I told you here, right? So this is how the interferometer is. So you can treat it like a bucket. Okay, so interferometer is like a bucket and it has a particular frequency. Look, pay attention to the frequency. It is 20 hertz to a kilohertz. So it's actually like an audible, it's sitting in the audible range, okay? So when, let's say, as they are merging, when they come close to each other, the signal enters this 20 hertz, when it becomes, you know, comparable, gravitational wave frequency coincides with this 20 hertz, it enters the detectors, and then it merges, increases the frequency, and it merges. Okay, so that's how the signal looks like. Okay, and that is what I've shown here. So you can consider this to be that bucket. So this is a LIGO. Okay, we'll talk about this a bit later. Okay, so this is a LIGO, and this is how the compact binary coalescence happen. That is a merger of binaries happen. They just enter and merge. Okay, there are other sources, like, for example, when you talk about the supernova core collapse, they are somewhere here. Okay, so this is how the signal enters the detector. And now when the signal is entering the detector, first of all, you imagine that this signal is extremely tiny, okay? And it is sitting in the detector's noise. So you can look at this. So this is a signal here, which is shown in red. And this is the blue thing, is the noise of the detector. So the signal is deeply buried in the noise. And that's why what we say is that the surge of gravitational waves is actually the problem of finding a needle in the haystack. Okay, so you know that how the needle looks like. Okay, and you have to go and basically find it. So there's a little cartoon which just tells you that how much time it will take to really find such a needle. And as a result, finding or fetching such a signal is a challenge. And there are various methods which we use. And I'm just going to show you a video how we search gravitational waves. So essentially, based on the Einstein's theory, there are some, the Einstein's theory predicts what kind of signal, gravitational wave signal, a system can emit. Okay. So based on that, you can essentially construct a set of filters. Okay. So I can just play the video for you again. So imagine that this is such filter, and when you match this filter with this data, then wherever the signal is, you will get essentially a peak. Okay, you will see that there is a because it has matched at that point. Okay, and that's where we find the signal. So this is some kind of a phase matching technique which we use in gravitational waves to search for signals in the data. Now, this is one method. There is another method what we use is, imagine what I just told you. So you have a signal. So signal looks like this. As the time progresses, the frequency increases and the amplitude increases. So if you try to, project this information and draw it in on x-axis time, y-axis frequency, okay, and draw as an image, then what you will see as the time increases, the frequency also increases. And this is what we call as a chirp. This is actually called as a binary chirp. So what we try to do is we try to map the data, okay, into this particular map. And then you will try to find the shape of it and try to get the energetic pixels and try to see whether does it have any resemblance with the gravitational wave signal. So these are two different kinds of searches what we use. This, the previous one uses the Einstein's predicted waveforms. This one does not use any waveforms, but it essentially looks for the shapes of the signal in the time and frequency representation. Okay. If anybody wants to know more about these searches, you can ask me later. We can talk about it. All right. So now on September 14, 2015, okay, the search which I told you this, which mapped the data on this time and frequency map, okay, found an event which I'm going to make you hear. Okay, so I'm sure I think all of you must have heard it. So there is some noise, there is a background noise, like this. And then inside that, you can see at some point, at around this point, you can see that there is a chirp going up, right? So this is the chirp, which gives the sound like, right? If you want, I can play it again for you. So essentially on September 14, 2015, the two detectors, which are quite separated, almost 3000 kilometers away, they together observed the event, which is of this particular shape, this particular chirp-like shape, okay? And that is what essentially created a lot of excitement in the field. Which later on when there was a lot of scrutiny, okay, within collaboration. So I'm part of LIGO collaboration. And after almost the scrutiny of 3 months or so, we all came to the conclusion that this is essentially what we saw is essentially a merger event of two black holes, okay, which are in a binary system, emitting gravitational waves, as I have shown here. So you can see the video here. Okay, as they are coming close to each other, you can see the two black holes are coming close to each other, emitting gravitational waves as is shown here, and finally they merge, forms a single black hole, and then the final black hole essentially is trying to settle. Okay, so it's settling down. So the event, what we heard, was coming from such a system in the distant universe. It traveled that much distance and it arrived, the two LIGO detectors, on 14 September 2015. Okay, so how far was this event? This event was quite far. In fact, when the event occurred that time, on Earth, essentially the multicellular organism was just forming, so we were somewhere here. Okay, so it traveled a long distance and it came on Earth on 2015. All right, so what was the peculiarity of this event? So we found the masses of these black holes. So they are something like 36 times mass of the sun and 25 times the mass of the sun. This is 29. So together they become 65 solar mass, but the final black hole, what we saw, the mass was estimated to be 62 solar mass. And so as a result, the energy almost equal to 3 solar mass was emitted in the form of gravitational waves. So that amounts to something like 4 × 10⁻⁴ watts. Okay, which is several orders of magnitude, the amount of power which we receive from sun. So it was really massive event. Okay, the only thing is that it is such an event took place in the gravitational wave window. Okay, and our space-time fabric is so stiff that essentially it needs so much power to essentially perturb and produce gravitational waves of the order which this event produced. Okay. Of course, this event was very spectacular because it was quite bright, and that began the first, it began the era of gravitational wave astronomy. We announced this discovery to the entire world on February 11, 2016. It was quite spectacular that, because I mean, what was so unique about this discovery? I mean, there were lots of firsts, because it was the first direct observation of gravitational waves. It was the first direct observation of stellar masses. So till that point, nobody knew that you can have black holes in a binary system going around each other. Okay. It was also the first direct evidence of the collision of black holes, and the system, the black holes which we saw in this particular event, they are way higher masses than what was known in astronomy in those days. Okay, so the two black holes were essentially 36 solar masses and 29 solar mass, and in astronomy, using X-rays, essentially we have not seen any black holes, stellar mass black holes above 25 solar masses. So that opened lots of questions, and the discovery was quite spectacular. Immediately, after 2 years, our colleagues and pioneers of the field, namely Rainer Weiss, Barry Barish, and Kip Thorne, they received Nobel Prize in Physics in 2017 for their decisive contributions to the LIGO and the observations of gravitational waves. All right. So now now we'll just take few steps backwards and try to just remind ourselves what are black holes and what was known earlier. Okay. So that then we can understand what kind of, black holes we have seen so far, and how far the gravitational wave astronomy has grew since then. Okay, so let's begin. Just remind ourselves that essentially black holes are end stages of massive stars. So if you have, let's say, stars roughly greater than 10 times mass of the sun, okay, 8 to 10 times, then the less massive stars, essentially you have, let's say, hydrogen, then the hydrogen burns into the helium, like how our sun is. Okay, so our sun, essentially the hydrogen is getting converted into the helium, and it is currently in the main sequence star burning, right? Now, once the hydrogen fuel gets consumed, right, then essentially the star starts collapsing under gravity, because there is nothing to hold the gravity. And then at some point, when it starts collapsing, the temperature inside starts increasing, and then the helium starts getting converted. So this is how it happens. And if you have a very massive star, then you can have, you basically, it forms this onion like shells, where you have a hydrogen, then you have a helium, and so on and so forth, based on the, you know, components in the periodic table. So the whole point is, you have this onion structure, and if you have a very massive star, then essentially after a particular stage, okay, it goes through a super giant phase where the star becomes very hot, okay, and it becomes so hot that essentially it just blows off the outer layer, and then it explodes into supernova. And depending upon the star, then at the mass of the core, either it becomes a neutron star. So the neutron star is made up of soup of neutrons, dominated by neutrons and some protons. Okay, so it is made up of either neutron stars, or if it is more massive, then the gravity is so strong that it just collapses into essentially a black hole. Okay, so you have either neutron star or black hole. Now, when you talk about this gravity or compactness, essentially there is one measure which we always use to decide the compactness of an object. Okay, and this is another little exercise, if you want, you guys can do. So this compactness parameter is defined by this quantity, okay, which is called as 2gm by r c square. In fact, it is the ratio of m by r, and g and c is used to make this whole quantity dimensionless quantity. So alpha has no dimensions, okay, and you can sort of compute this number for any object which you know. So for example, if you compute for sun, then you know the radius of the sun is roughly 700,000 kilometers. I'm sorry about this. And the mass, right? So you can substitute this here and compute alpha. Okay, look at the value of the alpha here. Okay. Now you can compute the same quantity for neutron star. Neutron star is essentially a mass which is roughly 1.5 times mass of the sun, and the radius, which is typically the radius of any small Indian town. Okay, let's say radius of Pune, for example, 10 kilometers. Okay, so imagine mass equal to one and a half times mass of the sun is packed into such a small place. Okay, then essentially the pressure is so much, the density is so much, okay, that it does not remain in the form of solid, but it becomes a soup of neutrons and protons. And if you compute, and it has very high gravity because of that, and the object is very compact, you can compute alpha for this, okay, that comes closer to 1, it's 0.4. The same quantity, if you compute for black hole, alpha is equal to 1. Okay, so the compactness. So when we say compact objects, are objects which have this alpha parameter closer to 1. And such objects, they are very compact, and as a result, they are very highly gravitating. Okay, they have very strong gravity. All right. Okay, and these are the objects which produce higher amplitude of gravitational waves. Okay, so black hole is extremely compact object with extreme gravity. Okay, classically speaking, essentially it is an object with the escape velocity equal to the speed of light. Okay, so no particle, even light, cannot escape black hole. it was predicted long back, okay, by Schwarzschild. And he gave this Schwarzschild's solution. And of course, those who have learned general relativity, they would know that the in the solution you get you know, the singularity, right, at r equal to zero. And also you can compute how the trajectory of particles around black holes and all that stuff. Okay, now the first evidence of black holes came in X-ray astronomy and via this object called as Cygnus X1 in 1964. And in fact, this is a very interesting thing about this particular event, is that there was this copious X-rays were observed, and people sort of thought that it could be a black hole. But the confirmed evidence about this that this is indeed black hole actually came much later, after almost 2 or 3 decades. After the observation of this event, and essentially there was a bet between Kip Thorne and Stephen Hawking about this, whether this Cygnus X1 is indeed an X-ray, is indeed a black hole. So what is this source? This source is essentially, it's an accreting source which is accreting matter on this central object, and because of this accretion, okay, it's highly spinning system, and it emits this jet essentially, and it emits X-ray. So it was observed in X-ray, also in radio you can observe Cygnus X1. In fact, last year this object came into sort of limelight again, because there is some new measurements with this very large baseline interferometer called as VLBI, which actually used a method to improve the distance measurement, and using that they essentially found that the central black hole is not 15 solar mass, but it is actually 21 solar mass, and hence it sort of came into limelight last year. All right. So now, so what we gathered is, one way you can form black holes by stellar evolution, okay, basically going through the life cycle of massive star. However, if you have very massive stars, okay, then they cannot be formed using this process, because very massive stars, they are essentially very unstable, and because of which there is some mass range between 65 to 135 solar mass. Of course, I mean, this is these numbers have some errors, and you cannot form black holes within this mass gap, okay, using this the life cycle of a massive star. Of course, if it becomes too massive, then you can form black holes, because there are no other things matter, essentially it just collapses into black hole because of too much gravity, okay. But this discovery of the event, this 1509-14 stands for 14 September 2015, that had masses 36 and 29, and that sort of raised eyebrows of a lot of people, because so far in the X-ray astronomy, as I had told you earlier in the previous slides, that's how we used to always observe black holes. They have never seen anything of this kind, of these masses. And people started wondering that maybe besides stellar evolution, there might be another way of forming black holes. Namely, it is quite possible that two black holes essentially merge and form a bigger black hole. That black hole might be merging with some other black hole later and forms a binary system, and eventually that might form another black hole, and so on and so forth. Okay, so maybe there is, of course, there were a sort of theories which said that such a hierarchy of black hole mergers might be happening, okay, but the evidence of this system essentially started, everybody started thinking that that might be a possible formation channel for not just the really big black holes, but even black holes of, let's say, 30s and 20s and, you know, that kind of solar masses. Okay, so besides this stellar evolution, the hierarchy of successive mergers can also form black holes. And that was a very interesting thing, which everybody is now taking it very seriously. In fact, we do not know that how the, you know, at the centers, you have these centers of the galaxy of the supermassive black holes. And nobody knows how the supermassive black holes are formed. And one possible scenario, people think that it must be because of the hierarchy of mergers of smaller and smaller black holes. You have bigger black holes and then they merge and so on and so forth. Okay. Just a slide on supermassive black holes. So in fact, in 2020, Nobel Prize in Physics went to supermassive black hole measurement of the supermassive black hole at the center of our galaxy, where the Nobel laureates essentially mapped the orbit of a star, okay, near this around the Sagittarius A star, and then using that they actually estimated the mass of the supermassive black hole to be 4 million M sun. Okay, so now besides the stellar mass black holes and supermassive black holes, there are these intermediate mass black holes, which are typically black holes above 100 solar mass. And they have been always sort of, you know, black holes of elusive nature, because it is very difficult to confirm that a particular system does harbor black holes, because if you cannot observe black hole directly, there is always an indirect way of observing. In fact, there are some candidates of these kind of black holes, which with the mass something like, so there is this HLX1 with estimated mass of 100,000 mass of the sun. And we think that with the gravitational wave astronomy, we should be able to shed light on this black holes of this masses, this population. Okay. These intermediate mass black holes are very interesting because there are theories which essentially says that the supermassive black holes must have been formed because of the mergers of very high mass, intermediate mass black holes. Okay. So discovering the population of these systems is very important for the, you know, formation of the supermassive black holes, as well as the galaxy formation itself, which is currently some of the open questions. Okay, so now with this background of different types of black holes, okay, I'm the last part of this talk. Let me just see how much time I have. Okay, can I take another 5-10 minutes?
Yeah.
Okay, fine. Okay, so the last part of the talk, which I'm just going to give you a glimpse of where we are now. And so essentially we completed from September 2015 till March 2020, we completed 3 observation runs of various durations. And in these observation runs, we improved the sensitivity of LIGO. In the second observation run, Virgo, the Italian, Italian-French detector also joined. So Virgo is sitting essentially in the outskirts of Pisa city. Together they started doing the observation. So basically this is roughly 5 years from September 2015 to March 2020. And using this, this was the first catalog of gravitational wave transient catalog. I just wanted to show you how the events look like. So you can see you know, the first event, I showed you this time frequency sort of map where the frequency is going up and with time. Okay, so now you can see a sort of a zoo of chirps coming from different sources, different kinds of sources with different masses. All are binary systems with varying masses and varying spins. Okay, the black holes also have spins. There is a one system which is a binary neutron star, and basically the smaller is the system, it takes a longer time to merge. Okay, so you can see here that this is the longest sort of track, time frequency track of the gravitational wave signal. All right, so and you can also see that it is not very clean. I mean, there is a lot of noisy features are lurking around, which we always need to fight all the time in order to really claim that we have observed something astrophysical. All right, so this first catalog, now we have many events. So this is the first catalog where we had 10 binary black holes and one binary neutron star, which we call it the GWTC1. Eventually, we published GWTC2, where we had almost like close to 50 events. All of them were compact binary mergers. And some of them, so we had in this, we had two binary neutron stars. There was one neutron star black hole system. This is essentially, I mean, in electromagnetic window, nobody has observed neutron star black hole system. So this is essentially the first neutron star black hole system observed. And you can see that we are essentially observing many sources as the detectors are getting more and more sensitive. All right, so now so far we are very close to, roughly, I would say close to a century or little less, but the gravitational wave astronomy is growing quite rapidly. The main reason is that our sensitivity goes as with age, and even if you improve little bit in the detectors, then that much far we can see in the distance. And when we measure the events, you are actually measuring the volume, and hence, you know, you grow even much faster. All right, so now I'm just going to tell you few highlight sources. I have chosen 5 sources among this almost close to 100 sources. The first one is the binary neutron star system. It's one of the very fabulous and fascinating system we observed in 2017. So it was 17th August 2017. And the spectacular thing about this event was that it was observed in one of the LIGO detectors. So you can see this chirp going up, observed here. And very soon, within 2 seconds, there were 2 triggers. One in the Fermi GBM. So both are basically the space missions. In Fermi and in Integral, okay, there was a coincident trigger just within 2 seconds, which was observed, and this was the short gamma ray burst. So what we found was, so in fact, this event was very sort of special because for a long time, the gamma ray astronomers have been observing the short gamma ray burst. And they're not able to find out what is the progenitor, what is the source which is giving rise to such a huge burst, such a powerful burst. They had, they thought that this must be because of some compact object, because these bursts used to be very short in duration. However, there was no conclusion. There were theories that the binary neutron star might be the plausible progenitor. And this was the event which essentially nailed down the scenario that the binary neutron star is indeed the progenitor of one of the progenitors of the short gamma ray burst. because you saw the gamma ray burst, short gamma ray burst, in coincidence just after the binary neutron star merger. Okay, so I think that created a lot of excitement. After that, almost close to 70 telescopes, both in space and ground, in various wave bands, right from radio to, you know, X-rays, optical, everything was essentially following this event. And they gathered a huge science. We learned a lot from this event, jointly observing this event in electromagnetic spectrum and in gravitation. Okay, right. So this is about this event. The next event, which was quite interesting, this is 17/08/14. So this is 14th August 2017 event, and this was the first event observed by two LIGOs and a Virgo. So you can see that there is this chirp here, and then you can see a tiny patch here. Okay, the Virgo was not as sensitive as the two LIGOs, which you can see here. And as a result, what they could use, the Virgo could actually help in improving the patch, the sky patch, where the source has come from. Okay, using Virgo, we could do that. Okay, but since it was the first three triple detector event, we could actually try to probe whether compute the polarization, the gravitational wave polarization, this plus cross, you know, and with that of you know, other possibilities, because only Einstein's gravity gives this plus cross. But if you have, let's say, non GR, some other alternative theory of gravity, which is not the Einsteinian one, you can also predict scalar mode or vector mode or a combination. Okay, and we could sort of test all that with this event. All right. I would sort of, okay, so this was another event which was quite interesting. This was more interesting from essentially because what we think is that you always see events which are symmetric, like two masses are similar, but this was the first asymmetric binary black hole which we observed with 30 solar mass and 8 solar mass. And with this we could actually probe the, you know, the higher, what we call is the structure, the higher other structure in the signal, and hence this was more interesting. Okay, this event, which happened in 2019, which is 25th April 2019, this event is more interesting because essentially it is it's a system with primary 1.6 solar mass to 2.5 solar mass. Okay, and the total mass of this system is essentially higher than any binary neutron stars you have observed so far. So if you take any galactic, the binary neutron stars observed in the galaxy, in our galaxy basically, then this is where they fall, the total mass basically. And this event had a total mass completely outside this. And this was very interesting. So people are wondering what can form such a event, or in fact, what can form the primary mass to be quite high. And there are theories to explain this particular event. I'm going to skip this event. It is quite similar to the previous asymmetric event, but I would like to speak about this event because it's quite close to what we do in the LIGO-Virgo collaboration, which is this search for intermediate mass black hole systems. This is the first intermediate mass black hole system was observed with the remnant mass below 1000 solar mass. So it's the first confirmed direct detection of an intermediate mass black hole. which is of the mass equal to 142 solar mass. So you can see the object is like a blob almost, because since the system is very massive, it merges very quickly. And since it merges very quickly, you don't see that chirp-like structure. You see essentially what you're seeing here. Okay. And finding these systems is extremely challenging. And they are also rich with a lot of science. So for example, if you look at this system, it was a two black holes, one of 85 solar mass and another is 66 solar mass, merging to form a 142 solar mass black hole. Okay. So for both these black holes, there are questions because they do fall exactly in that the mass gap which I was talking about. Okay, because so there is no way these black holes could have been formed by just because of the death of a very massive star. So they must have been formed maybe because of the merger of something else, and hence this this system is quite interesting because that opens up questions about this hierarchy of merger scenario, which I just talked a while. Okay. All right. So I'm going to skip testing of GR observation, just a punchline that we have tested Einstein's theory with these observations. There was nothing unusual found with that. All right. So now future. So essentially, the next run is going to start end of this year. Right. And then where we are going to improve the detectors. So this is where O4, which is this gray line which you see here. So this is going to be an improved version. And as a result, you're going to see much deeper in the sky. So for example, if you take binary neutron stars, you will see almost like 1.5 times up to 180 megaparsec, you will see in the next run. And if you go to the run after that, which is going to be the really advanced run where you might see three times more. So by the time, and all these things will happen in next few years, essentially. So we are not very far away. In next few years, you will see many more sources, many more black holes, right? Neutron stars, and, essentially we'll explore compact binary mergers up to a particular distance. And that's very exciting. Of course, we expect that the Japanese detector, which is getting constructed 3 kilometer arm length, will join, and that will help us in in localizing, in improving our sort of algorithms, as well as seeing much deeper and gathering more events and science. With all these events, we expect to observe black hole populations, compact binary population, also the distribution of mass, spin, eccentricity, how they are distributed. Because the moment you get a population, then you ask a question, how such systems are formed. Like it asks you a question about the whether they are formed in isolated state or they are formed in some dense environment like globular cluster or maybe centers of the galaxies. It also is going to help us to probe Einstein's theory, test it in the stronger regimes, and many more things we expect to learn with all these binary events. So, of course, there are various challenges, which if anybody is interested, we can talk about in the question answer session. Future ahead, there are a few missions already. Some of them are already sort of in pipeline. They are about to get approved. So there is one mission, which is LISA, which is a laser interferometric space antenna. This is the ESA and NASA project to basically send three satellites just in Earth's orbit, trailing Earth's motion, and essentially of million arm length, which will try to see, observe the whole universe of gravitational waves in the lower frequencies and try to get complementary information. Also, there are some future detectors like Einstein telescope, which is supposed to be underground. Cosmic Explorer, they're planning it to be something like 40 kilometer arm length and so on and so forth. So basically the future of gravitational wave astronomy is extremely rich. With Cosmic Explorer, if essentially the target projection of these instruments essentially is to see all the way, essentially capture all the binary black holes and the black holes in the universe. Okay. And this will happen in next couple of decades, or maybe in two or three decades, but not very far away. So with this, I'm going to stop here. Okay. If there are any questions, please ask. I have dropped some resources for students. I mean, there are some games which people can play. This is a very interesting game, which is a black hole hunter game. It's a game where you have to just put your headphones and then they will make you hear the signal in the noise, and just hearing it, and then they will show you different signal sort of templates, and then you need to identify which signal is hidden in the noisy data. So it's quite interesting game, and then there are levels and things like that, like for any other game. And then there are other pages which you can go into where you'll find science summaries written for each of these events which I talked about. We generally, as a collaboration, we do write science summaries which are reachable to students like you. Okay. And there is more information, more links and things like that. Those who are interested to play with data, they can also play with data. There are links on this open science, gwopenscience.org. There are also open data workshops. I mean, those who are interested to just follow the tutorials and learn by themselves. And I think with that, I will stop and take, if there are any questions, we can discuss them. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. This was absolutely a wonderful lecture. Thanks again for pointing out the references so that the excited people here can definitely go on and check them out. So in the interest of time, we'll just maybe like take one or two quick questions. So if you have any questions, please do raise your hand or type it out in the chat, and we can take them up. So there's just one question which came up. So while we're in the measure of compactness, why is there a factor of two added, the radius?
Okay, that is just to make, so I think those who know GR, essentially, you will see this. So this essentially is R. So set alpha equal to 1, then R is nothing but the Schwarzschild radius. So basically this 2 comes, this 2 is there to just make alpha equal to 1. That's it. Am I audible?
And so if there are other questions, do feel free to write to us in our email ID, and we can definitely get them answered. So again, I think do join me in thanking Professor Archana for this lovely overview of what has gone in the field of gravitational waves middle in the last decade or so. And it was really great to see how things unraveled. And thanks again for pointing out for what is to come. And I think the talk was wonderfully structured. So thank you very much for that.
Thanks a lot. Thank you very much. Yeah, if there are more questions,
thank you, Professor.
Yeah, sure. So if you have any more questions, you can just send it to me. That is also fine. Yeah.
Oh, thank you.
Okay.
That's good. And so we meet again at 6:30 p.m. tonight, which is in roughly an hour from now, wherein Professor Akshay Venkatesh of the Institute of Advanced Studies, Princeton University, will be talking to us about counting and finding integer solutions to polynomials. So I hope to see you all there, and thank you very much again, Professor Archana.
Okay, goodbye.
Goodbye, thank you. Have a nice day.